And a lot of people actually wrote to me and said, oh, wow, you're alive. Gosh, I didn't know. I thought you were a dead poet. So I get that quite often in the beginning. And the other one is, oh, you're a girl. I thought you were, you know, a boy. I was born in a refugee camp in Thailand. My parents were fleeing the Khmer Rouge regime. So then we emigrated to Sydney, settled in Cabramatta, and that's where I grew up.
How much did your parents tell you about escaping the refugee camp and coming out?
They don't really like to talk about it too much. I think it really upsets them. But, you know, as you're growing up, you hear bits and pieces. You can piece together this narrative. And because I lived in Cabramatta, all my friends, we all were from similar backgrounds. Yeah. We were all migrants, you know, from different parts of the world who went through similar experiences of displacement. It always seemed normal to me. It wasn't until, you know, I went to university that I mixed with lots of other different people that it occurred to me that no, life wasn't like this for the majority of people. Most people, you know, grew up, you know, not ever having known war and their parents not knowing war. So I always say English is, it's not my first language, but it's my first love. So I thought I'd be a teacher. So I did my first year in universities in teaching. But one of those nights where I just posted some of my poems onto Tumblr and a literary blog came along and reblogged it, and then my work just started to go viral.
So this poem is completely blowing up on Tumblr. Are you that person sitting there just going refresh, refresh, refresh?
Yes, absolutely. Texting my family, I've got X amount of followers now. Yeah.
Really?
I've lost count now. It's over 2 million now, but I've sort of stopped counting. And we were just watching the numbers like tick over, and you know, it just started climbing from the hundreds, which was incredible. I mean, before that, 40 was probably, you know, my record. Mm. And I was quite happy with that, but then it went into the thousands, the tens of thousands, and then it was hundreds of thousands.
I read you say something that that being a translator for your parents kind of contributes to, I guess, the pristine nature of the way you write. How do you mean?
They didn't speak English, and you know, it's something that I learnt in school very early on. Mm. I felt that language had to be distilled because things get lost in translation. I just had to simplify the language. So I suppose that's where that simplicity comes from, and I think it's actually quite difficult to write simplistically. I self-published my first book, and it started to make the bestseller charts in America. A couple of days later, I had a publisher on board.
There's a prevailing thought that poetry is a dead art.
Yeah.
It's only something that gets written up in literary publications. If somebody is watching this, that is their view of poetry, what would you say to them to convince them that there's life in it?
Well, it's funny because when my first book came out, Love and Misadventure, it was sitting next to, you know, Shakespeare and Edgar Allan Poe. And a lot of people actually wrote to me and said, oh, wow, you're alive. Gosh, I didn't know. I thought you were a dead poet. So I get that quite often in the beginning. And the other one is, oh, you're a girl. I thought you were, you know, a boy. It really is uncharted territory. I mean, it's something that I suppose hasn't really been walked much before.
When you travel, particularly around Asia, sometimes you even have to travel with a security guard.
Yeah, a team of security guards.
Which,
yeah,
is incredible.
In certain countries, I can't actually, you know, leave my hotel without security. And I get recognised on the street, and really weird, surreal things like that. And then my last signing in the Philippines, they had to actually stop it at 1,000, and it filled out like a few hours before the event, and people were lining up. Camping overnight.
Camping overnight.
That's why we need the security.
Yeah. I've heard you say that growing up in Cabramatta, there was an inherent melancholy to the area.
Yeah.
Walk me through that.
You know, just looking back at it now, it was a lot of people were from war-torn countries, and not that it was a sad place. It was also a joyful, happy, hopeful place as well. And you know, those two things aren't exclusive of each other.
No.
But you know, a lot of people lost their whole lives. They lost family members. It's just pervasive throughout the
And you felt it as being pervasive?
Yeah, I think it's something that I, you know, absorbed as a child, and it makes its way through my work.
You said that a melancholic person is more likely to pick up a pen. Why do you think that actually is?
Well, I think sadness adds something to literature that is wholly unique. It's like an ingredient in a dish. It's like salt. Mm. And it completely transforms a dish. And I think that that's the powerful effect that sadness has on literature.
Thanks so much for talking to us. Really appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.